On November 20th, 1953, the bustling skies above Edwards Air Force Base were taken over by a heavily modified Boeing B-29 Superfortress. Nestled beneath its massive belly was the Skyrocket, the final of three experimental aircraft. Inside the Superfortress, NACA test pilot Albert Scott Crossfield Jr. handled the controls. Today was no ordinary flight. Today, they aimed to break a barrier no man had ever crossed. The bomber climbed steadily, engines straining. At 18,000 feet, Crossfield entered the cramped cockpit of the Skyrocket. Strapped in, he ran through final checks, feeling the weight of history on his shoulders. At 32,000 feet, the Skyrocket was released from its mothership, dropping before its rocket engine ignited, and it initiated a steep climb. The acceleration pinned Crossfield to a seat as the Skyrocket soared. Mach 1 passed, then Mach 1.5, the aircraft steady and sure. Crossfield pushed the nose down slightly, initiating a shallow dive. The Skyrocket surged forward. Just then, Crossfield scanned his instruments intently. The Skyrocket's frame vibrated as it accelerated, pushing towards a speed no human had yet reached in level flight. The Mach meter needle crept closer to 2.0, then suddenly jumped past it, reaching 2.005. In the wake of World War II, the aviation world hungered for high-speed research to push the boundaries of flight. This drive was mainly fueled by the turbojet revolution, which dangled the tantalizing prospect of speeds beyond the speed of sound. However, reaching such velocities wasn't just a matter of more powerful engines. It meant grappling with quite complicated aerodynamic challenges, particularly in the realms of transonic and supersonic flight. Fighter aircraft like the P-38 Lightning were already brushing against these speed limits in dives, only to be torn apart by forces their materials and composition were never designed to withstand. All across the United States, a race was on. The Army Air Forces, Navy, and National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, or NACA, all scrambled to launch projects aimed at cracking the high-speed puzzle. While the Air Force's predecessor set its sights on rocket power, funding the X-1 project, NACA and the Navy chose a different path. They joined forces on a more measured approach, the D-558 program. For the Navy, this initiative was a bid to sharpen its technological edge ahead of the looming Cold War. NACA, meanwhile, saw an opportunity to fill crucial gaps in aerodynamic knowledge, potentially revolutionizing both military and civilian aviation. Together, they would create a record-breaking aircraft. Originally, planners envisioned a three-phase D-558 program. Phase 1 introduced the D-558-1 Skystreak, a straight-wing jet-powered aircraft designed for transonic research. Equipped with a General Electric J-35 turbojet engine, it could reach speeds just below Mach 1. Taking its maiden flight on January 25, 1947, the Skystreak went on to set several speed records during its operational period, providing critical data. Next came the D-558-2 Skyrocket, equipped with both turbojet and rocket engines for expanded research into higher speeds and altitudes. Rounding out the program, the tentative Phase 3 involved the design and mock-up of a combat aircraft. The original plan called for the engineers to reuse or modify the D-558-1 Skystreak fuselage to accommodate the program's second phase. This idea quickly proved impractical, as the model structure lacked the space and strength to integrate both engine types safely. As such, the D-558-2 emerged as an entirely new aircraft. This redesign birthed the Douglas D-558-2 Skyrocket, a series of three aircraft sharing key features: swept wings for enhanced high-speed performance and rocket engines for supersonic flight research. Each model stretched 42 feet in length, with a 25-foot wingspan, weighing 9,421 pounds empty and 15,787 pounds at maximum takeoff. Despite outward similarities, sleek, streamlined fuselages minimizing drag and maximizing stability, each Skyrocket boasted unique characteristics and history. NACA 143, the first D-558-2 Skyrocket, launched an ambitious flight research program at California's Mirac Flight Test Unit, now NASA Dryden Flight Research Center. On February 4, 1948, pilot John F. Martin completed its maiden flight, taking off from Rogers Dry Lake. Initially jet-powered, NACA 143 later received a rocket engine. Douglas tested this configuration from 1949 to 1951. Years later, the contractor modified it for all-rocket air-launch capability, removing the jet engine. Research pilot John McKay flew this version once for familiarization on September 17, 1956. This model primarily served Douglas for initial performance tests and validating wind tunnel predictions. Aircraft 1 completed 123 flights, laying the groundwork for the Skyrocket program's subsequent achievements. The second Skyrocket, 144, underwent modifications for air launch from a B-29 Superfortress, a model previously used for the newly established Air Force, and transferred to the Navy. During 21 initial tests, NACA pilots Robert A. Champine and John H. Griffith conducted airspeed calibrations and researched longitudinal and lateral stability and control. These flights revealed Model 2's tendency to pitch up under certain aerodynamic conditions. Engineers recognized this pitch-up problem as a serious issue, potentially imposing dangerous restrictions on flight performance. With this, a new change was on the horizon for the Skyrocket. After thoroughly investigating the problem, Douglas engineers replaced the turbojet with the reaction motor's LR8RM6 rocket engine in 1950, producing 6,000 pounds of thrust. Following this modification, Douglas Aircraft Company test pilot William Barton Bridgman flew the aircraft 7 times, reaching a speed of Mach 1.88. Little did he know, another unexpected record was just around the corner. On August 5, 1951, merely 8 days after setting an unofficial world speed record, Bridgman embarked on yet another Skyrocket test. The number 2 model was airdropped at 34,000 feet from a highly modified Superfortress mothership, piloted by test pilot George R. Jansen. Taking off from Edwards Air Force Base in Southern California's high desert, the flight plan called for Bridgman to fire the rocket engine, allowing the Skyrocket to accelerate up to Mach 0.85 while climbing. As the Skyrocket continued accelerating to Mach 1.12, Bridgman increased the angle of climb. Initially, he was to continue ascending after engine shutdown until the model approached a stall on its maximum altitude. However, on the morning of the flight, Douglas Chief Engineer Ed Heineman instructed Bridgman to push over immediately when the engine stopped. This last-minute change would yield incredible results. Bridgman had no choice but to adhere to the engineer's flight plan. As the Skyrocket accelerated through 63,000 feet, it began rolling left. He attempted to correct, but control proved difficult in the thin air. When it rolled again, his controls failed to respond. Striving to maintain as calm as possible, the pilot lowered the Skyrocket's nose to regain control, then increased the climb angle once more. Still ascending at 70,000 feet and Mach 1.4, he had to lower the nose again to avoid losing control. Finally, at 76,000 feet, the engine cut out. Following his boss's instruction, Bridgman pushed the nose down, and the Skyrocket gracefully completed its arc. At that moment, knowing he'd fulfilled his duty, he glanced out the canopy and witnessed an awe-inspiring sight that few in history have seen. Quote, "She levels off silently. I roll right, and there it is. Out at the tiny window slits, there's the Earth, wiped clean of civilization. A vast relief map with papier-mâché mountains and mirrored lakes and seas. It is as if I am the only living thing connected to this totally strange, uninhabited planet 15 miles below me. The plane that carries me and I are one and alone." Post-flight analysis revealed that Bridgman and the Douglas Skyrocket had soared to 79,494 feet, surpassing any previous human altitude record. This marked the final flight with the Douglas test pilot, as the rocket plane was subsequently handed over to NACA. This particular Skyrocket would later extend its unofficial record altitude to 83,235 feet, eventually making 103 total flights. Despite these remarkable achievements, the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale didn't recognize these altitude records, as rules stipulated that aircraft making record attempts must take off under their own power to qualify. Not every test with the three Skyrockets went as smoothly as planned. On March 22, 1956, what began as a routine mission quickly spiraled into a nearly catastrophic failure. That day, the 144 model and its mothership were flying as part of the ongoing high-speed flight research program. When the modified Boeing B-29 Superfortress mothership climbed through the crisp California air, carrying the Skyrocket beneath its belly, a strange vibration began to shake the aircraft. Inside the cockpit of the Skyrocket, NACA research test pilot John Jack McKay felt his heart race. Suddenly, a deafening roar filled the air. Within seconds, The number 4 engine's propeller started spinning wildly out of control. It broke free, sliced through the adjacent number 3 engine, tore into the fuselage, and struck the number 2 engine on the opposite wing. The B-29 shuddered violently, threatening to break apart at any moment. Knowing there was no way he could do his test now, McKay's voice crackled over the radio time and time again, quote, "No drop." It was too late. The pilots at the stricken B-29 had made a split-second decision to jettison the skyrocket. According to logs and documents, only a moment later, the B-29 prop tore loose and cartwheeled through the space the jettisoned skyrocket had just vacated. Plummeting through the air, McKay's training kicked in, and he steered the aircraft toward the safety of the lake bed below. Back in the damaged Superfortress, the pilot's muscles strained against the controls as they struggled to fly the aircraft back to safety. As the dust settled on the lake bed, with both aircraft miraculously intact and all crew members safe, the gravity of the situation became clear. There was no question that the loose propeller would have torn into the skyrocket's fuel tanks, creating a fireball that would have claimed everyone aboard both aircraft. The young pilots aboard the B-29 were Stanley Paul Burchard and none other than a young Neil Alton Armstrong. Only 13 years later, he would be the first man to land on the moon. The third and final D-558-2, number 145, was used purely by NACA in a highly specialized program, focusing on aircraft behavior at supersonic speeds and the associated aerodynamic phenomena. Powered by pure rocket power, by removing the turbojet engine, NACA and the Navy were finally ready to achieve the milestone the entire program was built for. On November 20, 1953, at Edwards Air Force Base in California, NACA test pilot Albert Scott Crossfield Jr. prepared for a groundbreaking flight. He boarded the Douglas D-558-2 skyrocket, carried by a Boeing P-2B-1S Superfortress to its launch altitude. As the bomber climbed past 18,000 feet, Crossfield moved to the skyrocket's cockpit. The Superfortress then dove slightly to gain speed. At 32,000 feet, the smaller aircraft was released, dropping 400 feet before its rocket engine ignited, sending it climbing steeply. Crossfield ascended to 72,000 feet and leveled off. In level flight, the skyrocket sped past Mach 1, then Mach 1.5. Crossfield pushed the nose down for a shallow dive, and the plane continued to accelerate. At 62,000 feet, the skyrocket hit Mach 2.005, or 1,291 miles per hour, making Crossfield the first person to fly at more than twice the speed of sound. Moments later, when the rocket engine ran out of fuel, a happy Crossfield then smoothly glided back to a safe landing on Mach Dry Lake at Edwards Air Force Base. After achieving Mach 2, Crossfield and NACA pilots Joseph A. Walker and John B. McKay used the skyrocket to gather data on pressure distribution, structural loads, and structural heating. The program's final flight occurred on December 20, 1956, when McKay collected data on dynamic stability and sound pressure levels at transonic speeds, marking a total of 83 flights for this model. Overall, between 1948 and 1956, the three D-558-2 skyrockets made a total of 313 flights. The three aircraft from the skyrocket program gathered significant data about pitch up and the coupling of yaw and pitch motions, wing and tail loads, lift, drag, and overall characteristics of swept-wing aircraft at transonic and supersonic speeds. The number three aircraft also gathered information about the effects of external stores, such as bomb shapes and drop tanks, upon the aircraft's behavior in the transonic region. However, the third phase of the D-558 program, which would have involved constructing a mock-up of a combat-type aircraft built upon the results from the testing of Phases 1 and 2, was never actually developed. This decision was made partly because this hypersonic aircraft would have been very similar to the North American X-15, which was also developed and tested during this period.